So our next guest, he grew up in the companion of E.T., Star Wars, Top Gun, Rambo, Commando, and the first 8-bit commercial computers like Atari, the Commodore, and what I had as a kid, which was the ZX Spectrum. Yes, it was good. Currently, he manages the development of software that offers a broad range of functionalities and data solutions to help airlines and travel agencies market themselves, sell products, serve customers, and operate more efficiently.
He started his career way back in 2001 as a software engineer working with complex systems and engineering problems. He loved every minute of it ever since. Today, he's here to speak to us about, well, his subject is 2030 outsourced by intelligent machines. Really. Please welcome on stage Łukasz Łętocha.
Now it will be a bit darker, but I hope we'll make it. So imagine that between 400 to 800 million individuals will be displaced by automation and will need to find a new job by 2030. Do you believe it? Probability is high that some of us will be displaced by robots in 20, 30 years. I remember when I was a small kid in a mid-1980s, when I first experienced autonomous car, alien species, robots. Later, when I was a teenager, telekinesis, augmented reality, interplanetary transport, and doom of war between humans and cyborgs. Indeed, all through movies, computer games, books, and comics. Many of us couldn't even name those things at that time, but in the heads of many early innovators, those ideas started inspiration to build one of those technologies and machines of today. We couldn't even believe that it is something that we can have in our times, but here they are, our closest companions. So what does it mean for our societies? What does it mean for economy? What does it mean for us all here? Will any jobs be left for humans? What if a machine and a human will work side by side? Which one will make decision? Those are questions companies, industries, and economies are facing as digital technology transform our world. We've been through technological change before, just not at this pace. Human progress has a very long history. Over thousands of years, we learned how to farm, communicate using paper, create first tools and machines, and came up with a revolutionary steam engine, which became a breakthrough. Breakthrough that over years started industrial revolution with mass production, assembly lines, and electricity. With machines taking large portion of human labor, other parts of society could concentrate on other things, in many cases creative, but it wasn't always nice. Riots, pollution, child labor were common. Many were badly affected by mechanization. People worked for many hours under conditions that were extremely unhealthy and dangerous. Years passed before regulations were put in place and conditions improved. Automation generated fear and opposition. Bad press was what characterized this time. Nowadays, we hear when a computer age began with the first modern computer that was proposed by Alan Turing in 1936. Over the following decades, progress was immense. And we all agree that this is something that we already know. It's a Moore's laws. It started automation in all areas of economy and industry. both steam engine and computers bent the curve of human progress almost 90 degrees, as British historian Ian Morris observed and quantified as a social development index over time. From now on, prosperity, innovation, improved standard of living became a fact, but not for all. Nowadays, we hear dreaded stories about line factory workers being displaced by automation. The great example is a carrier factory which became a major political symbol in 2016 when US president-elect promised to save jobs, but deep down, a lot of workers knew that it was not true. All manufacturing companies invest heavily in automation to bring costs down and gain competitive advantage. Ultimately, it means that there will be fewer jobs. Let's look at outside of manufacturing for a while. In 2017, McDonald's said goodbye to cashiers when welcoming Hello kiosks. They announced plans to roll out automated menus and mobile play options to all of their locations, raising questions about the future of their 1.5 million employees. After announcement of those plans, their stock went up immediately. It's a good business, and others already followed. Amazon has a chain of shops called Amazon Go, all equipped with hundreds of cameras and electronic devices to identify each customer and track items they select. All purchases are billed to customer credit cards when they leave the store. Although customers may welcome novelty and additional convenience, those conveniences come at the cost of entry-level jobs. Let's meet the cobots who work with factory workers. Those are not traditional heavyweight stationary robots as we know. Those are lightweight, mobile, plug-and-play generation that collaborate safely with factory workers thanks to advances in vision, sensor technology, and computing power. They can be easily moved and reconfigured, plus they don't catch colds, need brakes, lights, or insurance. Recent advancements in self-driving technology will soon displace taxi, delivery, and truck drivers. We already know that self-driving cars are being tested on the highways of California, but self-driving trucks are on the way with a heavy investment put into their creation. On the same path are self-delivery cars and package delivery drones. Robots will soon replace security guards as a self-driving surveillance vehicles. They aren't perfect or similar to R2-D2, but they are still learning in the field, as we see. Recent advancements in AI raises questions about lawyers and this profession. So general rule of thumb is that the most routinized the work is, the most likely it is to be automated. Majority of work or main task of lawyers sometimes, but not always, are very repetitive. If you look at the testament, loan agreements, contracts, those usually require to take a boilerplate document, adopt it to a client needs, filling in the gaps with the correct information. That's a perfect scenario for automation. Platforms such as Law Depot, LegalZoom, or Rocket Lawyer are already doing that. Advancements in AI raises questions about the future of human radiologists. Radiology and imaging are very expensive and costly, so any attempts means to lower labor costs, improve diagnostic accuracy, would benefit patients and physicians alike. Are we, Sabre, different than others? Absolutely not. We are doing it since we were born in 1960s. We helped to automate manual reservation systems with 8 operators and rotating card device. Progress in travel space since then is immense, and we are all in it. Let's look at some numbers. US manufacturing jobs went down by 5 million between 1917 and 2014. Only between 2000 and 2010, 85% of manufacturing jobs lost was due to technology. 13% was due to international trade. 25 people were employed for 1 million manufacturing in 1980s. Today, we need 5 people to produce the same amount of output. The effect seen in case of manufacturing will soon spread to other areas. What should keep us all at night is the fact that the most affected are in the worst position to do anything about it. Inequality will worsen. Automation will keep wealth in the hands of a few who owns the robots. We need to think about a new social structure, new purpose for human beings. So, what we can do about it since it is unavoidable? There is no perfect answer, but one option is to rethink and redesign social contract. Imagine how would you feel about making money without the need of work. For some of us, it can be a dream come true. Here comes universal basic income, idea widely discussed among economists and sociologists. It's a government cash payments to all people whose job will no longer be needed in a digital age. Although additional security allows people to become more risky, entrepreneurial, devote more time and energy to improve their communities, there is still opposition out there. Even big technology and business titans like Elon Musk, Mark Zuckerberg, Richard Branson, others promote basic income as a means to minimize effect of disruptive technologies. Canada gave it a try with a 3-year pilot program that provided up to $17,000 for 3 years, no string attached. The same with Finland, which introduced its own basic income experiment in 2017. Although both experiments weren't entirely successful and governments are looking at other options, the good thing is that government started to be more creative about addressing income inequality and other social issues. Even if universal basic income will be real, how to finance that thing? Since labor is starting to become capital, shouldn't we put taxes on robots? The idea is something that was proposed way back in 1940s by US Senator Joseph C. McHoney. In 1940s, the fear of automating out of jobs was quite significant, and even term technological unemployment was coined and was considered as a disease. Fortunately, the concerns turned out to be false, and post-war economic boom employed and uplifted many. Nowadays, we hear different opinions among business people, technologists, sociologists, politicians. Some say that taxing out the thing that increasing productivity the fastest is unwise and that robots are a big part of the economic picture going forward. Others say that the same robots that were meant to help humans actually robbing him out of the job and need to be taxed out of existence or process needs to be slowed down. Even Bill Gates believes that companies should be taxed by governments whenever they use robotic workforce. Income tax can finance underpaid teachers, nurses, caregivers, moms provide money for retraining. Governments should oversee such programs instead of relying on businesses. It's an unexpected statement from the world's richest man and the co-founder of Microsoft, the leader in artificial intelligence space. Lastly, we need to understand the importance of education and constant learning. There is a huge need to invest more in education, value teachers, create smaller classes. We need, or organizations need to provide lifelong learning resources for their employees. We need to look at new types of jobs emerging. Jobs like robotic research scientists, 3D printing manager, or machine learning engineers sounds around right. We need to stop with the philosophy of having people following instructions. We need to promote collaboration, communication, empathy, critical thinking, because those are areas hard to automate. The future belongs to creatives. And we need to understand that our next generation, our kids, need to learn those things to be able to compete with the robotic workforce. There needs to be drive in direction to educate more in highly specialized jobs that will augment or support AIs. There needs to be somebody who can maintain and grow those machines. Ladies and gentlemen, we are victims of our success and progress that is unimaginable faster right now than during industrial revolutions. Our lives are simple, safer, more comfortable, more interesting than those 12,000 years before us. And we have those machines everywhere. We need to understand that this is not a race against the machine. This is race with machines when we, humans, and robots need to work together, when robots need to do job that requires precision, is manual, dull, repetitive, can be dangerous, and we humans need to do job that requires human, personal, or creative touch. There must be intruding partnership between us and robots when we, humans, have a decisive voice. But we shouldn't give hope, since history has shown humans as versatile, immune, and adaptable to all changes dictated by unstoppable progress. Thank you very much.
Despair, wonderful.
Thank you very much, Łukasz.
Thank you very much.
I do believe we have some questions for you.
Yep.
Most likely.
Hopefully they will come up. Are they coming?
Oh,
there they are.
Oh, there
okay.
they are. So, how many years would it take to have robots instead of developers?
Oh, oh. Yes. That's something that interests us all, yes, or majority of cases. I think that's a tricky question. We already have some capabilities to generate the code, at least kind of a template, and developers know it perfectly. But I would assume that knowing that the code, our code, will somehow drive those AIs and robots, we need to still be involved to make sure that it is done in a way that is not giving us problems or, you know, anything like wars. We know that they are doing it, but, you know, generally we need to look closely at what is implemented in those machines. So I think we are safe, kind of.
Kind of.
Okay, so I think the answer to this one is quite obvious, to be honest, but will machines make better environmental and planet decisions than we do?
That can be true, yes, I agree, because, you know, it is like a decision, what is better, yes, based on some factors that you can calculate easily and put and close in algorithms. They can do it, but again, humans are, you know, empathical creatures. So we heard before, yes, on a previous presentation, but it is something that machines definitely will not do. And I don't believe that basing decision only on algorithms will help humanity in the future on many, let's say, many axes.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.